Yeah, so I am going to talk about something which normally people don't talk about. And guess what? That's sex. Okay, so sex has always been a taboo in our country. And of course, we all know sex education is not that well received, not well imparted in schools and colleges as well. And I remember when I was studying in school, that I got the chance of studying in the, one of the best schools of India in Bombay. And when the teacher used to come to talk about the human physiology, she used to talk about the secondary sexual characteristics of zebra or lion. And I used to think to myself, well, I'm not going to have sex with a zebra, or I'm not going to have sex with a lion. Why should I know what is happening with a zebra or a lion, you know? Anyway, so going back to history, I was born, of course, and I'm born in a royal family, and I'm proud of that. It's called like born in a, with a silver spoon. And I had the fortunate of getting my name also entered in the Ministry of Home Affairs, the Government of India, because the first male child born in the family in those days, and I'm talking prior to 1971, was entered in the Gazette of the Home Ministry. And then to being brought up in such a protected atmosphere with so much of protocols and norms and do's and don'ts, and raised by a governess, and no communication, no love and attachment with parents, because parents, my mother and father have never called me by my name. They have always called me by my title, that's the crown prince, or in Hindi it's called the Yuvraj. I have never called my mother mom, I have never called my father dad. I just saw the father and son, you or your call each other by dad. I have never called him dad. I've called him His Highness, and I called my mother Her Highness. So getting grown up in that kind of a lifestyle, and then coming to terms with my sexuality and not having anyone to talk about it, you can imagine what kind of a struggle it was. In those days when there was no internet, no cell phone, no means of communication, no Google, nothing to find out what I am. I didn't know what I was. I mean, I knew I was different. I mean, imagine all that, and then realizing, no, I'm different. And then in 2006, I made this big earthquake, and it was created in Gujarat, much bigger than the one in Kutch also. And and then the headline news came in the newspapers, in the Gujarati newspaper, the Prince of Rajpipla declares he's homosexual. And that was it. That was, I think, one of the biggest news of that day, rather. And the newspapers got sold so fast that I also never got a newspaper in my hand, you know. incidentally, the news came on, it was 14th March, and on the 14th March in the year 2006 happened to be Holi, the festival Holi, not the Dhuleti, but the day prior where, you know, you set fire, burn fire and all. And the people of Rajpipla, they just couldn't digest this idea, and then they did a bonfire, and they all burnt my effigies in the fire. And they had there's a lot of protest happening in the town, and people they were saying, oh, you should be stripped of his title, he should be exiled, he should be excommunicated, he's brought shame, humiliation to the family, all that. And for what? Just because I spoke the truth, and nothing else but the truth. But you see, speaking the truth is not easily digestible by a lot of people, because it is said that truth is bitter. When we try to be honest, we try to be truth, people don't understand that. We are not ready to accept it. So, but I said nothing doing. I'm going to speak the truth. If I'm gay, I'm gay, and I'm proud that I'm gay. Nobody in the world can stop me from doing that. I also never knew, but I got the title of the world's first openly member of a royal family to come out as gay, which I kind of never knew, but I didn't do it for publicity. I mean, I have been born in a family where we had always been raised with paparazzi. So I didn't want media publicity, but I wanted to come out as truth. I wanted to break the hypocrisy in prevailing in the society that, homosexuals, they were never in India. I said, okay, if homosexuality was not in India, then who wrote the Kama Sutra? Was it written by an American guy? Was it written by a British guy? No way. It was written by an Indian guy, Indian saint, 500 years even before Jesus Christ was born. And there is a whole chapter depicting homosexuality, lesbianism, transgenderism. There are paintings, there are photographs, illustrations of how two men can have best sexual positions, how two women can have best sexual positions. Where did that come from? If you say homosexuality was not there. So that's hypocrisy. We have statues in Khajuraho, in a lot of other temples in India, which are openly depicting homoerotic forms of statues and sculptures. Where did those statues come from? We never imported it from outside. On the contrary, if somebody says that, oh, homosexuality was not in India, I said, I'm sorry, my dear friend. It was there. We exported it to the other countries rather. When I go abroad, Kama Sutra is so popular, you know? I mean, it's like, you know, so shameful that we Indians are only not bothered about what our people have written. Kama Sutra is a very popular book if you go to Europe or you go to some other country. And we ourselves don't know about it. So what a shame of our, we don't care about our culture, that means. So it was important to make people realize and accept. But of course, there are a lot of hypocrites in this world. So you have to bear with them. But I did not stop. And when the media asked me that, what do you have to say about these people who are volunteer refugees? My own parents, they brought out notices in the newspaper saying we are disowning our son from the family, we are disinheriting our son from the ancestral property because he has done something which is not acceptable by the society. That's what they brought out. And when I was made to comment, I simply said, I don't blame these people, I don't blame my parents, I don't blame the people who have burnt my effigies in the fire. I blame their ignorance on the subject. They are not aware of that. If I would be in that place, I would have also done the same thing. When sex education is not taught in schools, how would anyone know what is homosexuality? And I said, it is duty of me as an activist, as a human rights activist, to educate the people about what is homosexuality. And it is those people who are today have gone against me, are again going to come back to me. That was my guarantee. And that happened. That happened very soon. 2007 was a turning point in my life when Oprah invited me. In fact, she invited me in 2006 itself, but it was my mistake. I didn't know who Oprah Winfrey was. I mean, so many emails used to come, you know, like when I came out in 2006, I was very fed up. You know, my inbox used to get filled so fast, and I'm not that technically savvy person with internet and all that, you know. So even when she invited me in 2007, and I went to her and said, Oprah, I'm so sorry, I didn't reply to your mails because I'm not good with two things. I'm not good with emails, and I'm not good with females. So, she got my Oprah. She got my landline number at the palace, and she called me at Rajpipla, and then that's how I landed on the show. Anyway, her show was a big turning point because through her show, a lot of realities of life of India were brought out during her show. One of the things which she brought out was that 80% of gay men in India are heterosexually married to women, which not a lot of people in the world knew about it. Even a lot of Indians know that most of us are married. And why we are married? We are not wanting to get married, but our Indian parents specialize in emotionally blackmailing us. Indian moms, they will even after you tell them, I do a lot of counseling cases, so I know when some of my clients come to me, they say, oh no, I have to get married. I told my mom I'm gay, but still and I don't want to spoil the life of a girl, but still my mom insists on getting married. So I said, okay. And then he said, you know what, my mom says that if you don't get married, I will jump in the well. So I won't allow my mother to jump in the well, rather I'll jump into the well and get married to a girl rather than allowing the mother. Because we are so, even mentally conditioned, we are so attached to our parents that, you know, we can't see them suffer. So, and then they have to get married. So friends, this was what I came out for. I wanted discussions, I wanted debates to happen on the subject which has always been considered as a taboo in our country, which nobody wants to talk. There are so many myths, misconceptions. There are so many allegations people make against us. We are pedophiles, we convert. Oh, coming to conversion, let me tell you something very interesting. There has been so many people who are also making this allegation. Homosexuality, oh, they are mental people, you know. Oh, these homos, they are all mental cases, you know. They should be not here, they should be in mental asylum. As I think to myself, well, if I would be mentally ill, then I would not be standing here doing this TED talk. And really, this is my 10th TED talk I'm doing today. We fought the case, even though the religious leaders, for the first time in the history of India, all the religious leaders united. Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Parsis, you talk about the religion, even the Muslims, they fight amongst each other, they also united. All united and came, they fought, they filed an appeal against us in the Supreme Court, saying that homosexuality should not be decriminalized. So anyway, unfortunately, we lost in the Supreme Court in 2013 when the judgment came out. But we didn't stop there. We said no, nothing doing. We have to stick to our truth. We have to. And I was very sure, because I am another believer and a very great admirer of Gandhiji. Mahatma Gandhi is somebody who's really close to my heart. Today, a friend of mine, he has given me his charkha. I'm very happy to get that. And I always think, because he's a great source of inspiration, on the basis of truth and honesty and non-violence, when he could get the Indians freed from the Britishers, then why can't I, on the basis of honesty and truth, get the freedom for the LGBT community? So on his inspiration, we filed the curative petition in the Supreme Court, and last year, my friends, on 6th of September, a very auspicious number, 6-9, what does it mean? 69. So, 6th September 2018, we won the case. So finally, friends, hypocrites lost, humanity won. Thank you.